Behind the Shutter, the digital wedding photographer's guide to financial success, an enhanced audiobook for digital photographers. Based on the book, Behind the Shutter, the digital wedding photographer's guide to financial success, by Salvatore Cincotta. Narrated by Dan Leonard. Why write this book? This is the first question I get asked. And aren't you worried that everyone will know your secrets? No, I'm not afraid. A project like this is about raising the bar for our industry and giving back to a community of people who are hungry and curious to learn. I'm writing this book because it's my way of giving back. I am, after all, a professional photographer. I love my job. I take tremendous pride in our craft and the responsibilities given to us by our clients. However, with the advent of digital, it's become easier and easier for the weekend warriors to make their mark. And sometimes that mark is more of a burn. When I was starting out, there were plenty of books out there on lighting and posing, but there seemed to be very few books about the business of photography. After reading those books, I was left with so many questions and nowhere to go for answers. They seemed to present an old-school way of doing business. And our studio's brand is anything but old-school. The industry has changed so much in the short time we've been part of it, and it shows no signs of slowing down. One thing I learned in my years at Microsoft is that the only constant is change. Fortunately, as photographers, we are visionaries by nature. We must use this vision and see the future and predict how it will impact our business, then adjust our roadmap accordingly. Part of the reason so many studios are struggling is because they're having trouble navigating in these new and ever-changing waters. We've grown over 30% each year we've been in business. We're a studio based in a blue-collar Midwestern city, so if we can do it here, you can implement our strategy anywhere in the world and find success. So, how do we do it? Trust me, it's a lot of hard work. In the end, you must implement solid, foundational business practices. As artists, this is not something that comes easily to most of us. That's where this book comes in. Use it as your planning tool and an educational resource. Don't watch it once and put it down. Use it and refer to it often. This is a blueprint. How you implement this blueprint in your business will differ from how I implement it in mine, and how anyone else might put it to use in their studio. There's nothing magical to what we do. It's our X factor that allows us to take something that everyone can do and turn it into a thriving and profitable business. Nothing would make me happier than seeing more photography businesses thriving. I want success for all of my peers and for our industry as a whole. Every Saturday when I go out to shoot a wedding, I know that I'm an ambassador for our industry, and I try to be the best ambassador I can be. Keep shooting, and remember, we're not just photographers. We're visionaries, directors, historians, storytellers, and entertainers. But most importantly, we are artists. Our job is one of the most important in history. Don't ever forget it, and don't ever feel apologetic for being successful. Wedding business basics. So you want to be a wedding photographer. Well, what happens when the world comes a-knockin'? It's going to take more than a good eye and a few family friends letting you shoot their wedding to call yourself a professional photographer. You'll be doing yourself, the industry, and your clients a huge disservice as you present yourself as a professional before making the necessary investments to ensure you're holding yourself to the highest possible standards. While there are organizations that offer professional certifications, they're geared more towards the technical aspects of creating an image. We're going to take a look at some business basics. Jobs will be coming in and you'll soon realize that shooting and burning, as it's referred to, is not a business model. In the end, it will actually impede your ability to make a decent living and leave your clients wanting so much more. One of the first things I want to see and discuss every time I consult with a professional photographer is their business plan. Having a business plan is one of the most basic things you can do to ensure success. It's the only way to ensure that you and your staff are all heading toward your intended final destination. Trust me, I understand your misgivings and apprehension. You want to be a photographer, not a business school graduate. So let's embark on Sal's Business School Crash Course and begin to develop an understanding of some key terms and how they apply to your business and our industry. A business plan is a formal statement of your business goals and your strategy for reaching those goals. Regardless of your experience level, your plan should cover where you want to be and how you plan to get there in 12 months, 3 years, and 5 years. If you're like most small startups, writing out a business plan will be more of an exercise to document your direction and create your map. I like to keep it as simple as possible and maintain a notebook with all sorts of ideas, goals, and metrics. Metrics are objective values that help you calculate your success. What should be in your initial plan? At a minimum, you should identify your niche. It is weddings. But how about seniors, babies, families, and so on? How many weddings would you like to shoot? How much are you planning on charging? What will you offer? Will you be a low-cost photographer, or will you be more of an artist and a craftsman? How will you differentiate yourself in the market? What is your X factor? These are just some simple and painless ways to start your business or even reevaluate it to ensure that you have a clear path mapped out that everyone involved in the business can follow. When we first started out, our goals were very simple. Today, our numbers have changed dramatically, and our plan has become much more detailed. By 2011, we're looking for 50 weddings at an average of $9,000 and over 120 senior sessions at an average well above our 2007 numbers. How did we do it? We had a plan. We stuck to the plan, tweaked the plan as necessary, and continued to strive for excellence. So, hopefully, you get the point here. You must put a business plan together. If your business plan is what you plan on doing, your marketing plan is how you plan on doing it. But how are you going to accomplish it? That's the big question and the more difficult challenge. There are several approaches to consider. The wedding industry is an industry of relationships. It's all about referrals. So, how do you get these relationships? You develop them over time. When we first started out, we went around to all the top venues in our area, introducing ourselves, showing our work, and asking what it would take to be on their preferred vendor list. There was only one venue that believed in us and gave us a chance. Our very first year with them, we booked 75% of our weddings through that contact. Today, we're on the preferred vendor list of all the venues we want to work with. The takeaway here should be that relationships take time to develop. Give it time. keep doing a great job, and eventually you will get to know these people on a personal level. That's when the real fun begins. What about television or radio? I have to admit, I've never tried radio, and I'm in no hurry to do so. At the end of the day, we sell imagery. Given that radio is an audio-only medium, I'm not sure I'd really be hitting my target. Television is powerful. If it's done right, it can really set you apart. If it's not, it can be a costly mistake. Had we entirely abandoned television as a viable medium after an early disaster, we wouldn't enjoy the success we do today with a local morning show. Magazine advertising has been hit and miss for us. Here are my thoughts on magazine ads. It's all about exposure. To be effective, an ad has to get your name out there. People have to see your work and name over and over again. Finally, how about the internet and social media such as MySpace, Facebook, Twitter, and so on? It plays a monumental role in the success of your business. If you're new to the industry, make sure you have an internet identity that matches your brand and showcases great pictures. More and more, people want to sit in their homes and look for photographers online. They find them in a variety of ways, from search engines and online magazines to blogs and friends' Facebook pages. The point is, you have to have an online presence and strategy. Every day, I learn something new about my brides and how they find us. And we're discovering that almost all of them are well-versed in our blog and Facebook site. They look at the pictures, the slideshows, and the video, and they fall in love with us well before they meet us face-to-face. How's that for a marketing plan? As photographers, we're in the emotion business. If you can create excitement before you ever meet with the client, you'll find a lot of success. We invest heavily in our blog and Facebook site. We know the power of this medium and post as many events up there as possible. Your marketing recipe will be different than mine, and that's okay. For all of us, what works best will continue to evolve and develop over time. We've covered two major topics, business plans and marketing. Now I want to dig deeper into some metrics we use to run our business. While you might not need to review them every day, you do need to understand what they are and how they affect your bottom line. The number one question I get asked by aspiring photographers is, how should I price my work? Your cost of goods, or COG, is the amount you pay to create the products you're selling to clients. This value includes the materials, labor, and overhead you invest to produce your final products. Understanding these costs lets you know where you really have wiggle room and where you need to keep costs under control. Certain products or services will have more profit margin than others. When we're putting packages together, I like to keep my product costs under 15%. This gives us the margins we need to include labor, outsourcing, packaging, and so on. The cost of acquisition, or COA, is the price you paid to get a client. No matter how you book your events, there is typically a cost associated with it, unless, of course, you have that referral engine really well tuned. For us, we do a lot of bridal shows. There are two ways to use the COA value. First, you can calculate it on an event-by-event basis. For example, we paid $500 for bridal show X and booked four brides. The COA is $125. 500 divided by 4 equals 125. Alternately, you can calculate your COA for the year as a whole. For example, we booked 40 brides and participated in 8 shows totaling $8,000. Our COA is $200 per bride. $8,000 divided by 40 equals $200. the elite bridal shows are going to have a higher COA than the average bridal show. That's okay. I like to keep my COA at less than 10% of my overall sale. Each client will contract with you for a certain dollar amount depending on how you have your packages structured. The average dollar value of these sales is your contract average. For example, let's say you book three weddings at $3,000, $4,000, and $5,000, respectively. Your contract average for these events would be $4,000. Why is this number important? Because it allows you to do some forecasting and have an understanding of where your business is heading, whether you're trending upward or downward over time. You'll be able to adjust your pricing over time and ensure people are contracting at the price point you're looking for. The total spend reflects how much the client has spent with you after the contract, including, for example, engagement pictures and post-wedding sales. $3,000 for client contracts, $4,000 client spends of engagement and post-wedding prints, $7,000 total spend. This information is great for forecasting and figuring out your sales averages. You shouldn't be running your business based on guesswork. You can then use that information in planning for your next year's growth. Here's an exercise you need to go through in order to understand the importance of pricing. Let's start with an engagement session. We shoot our engagement sessions on location and usually spend about an hour and a half with the client. We then edit the images. Let's say that takes us an hour. Then, after about 2 weeks, the client comes in to see their pictures, and we spend an additional 2 hours reviewing and picking their images. At this point, we have 4.5 hours invested in the shoot. Now, let's consider a 4x6-inch print. In fact, we refer to 4x6s, 5x7s, and 8x10s as gift sizes and price them all the same. Why? Because, in all reality, it costs me the same to produce all three of them. Your client says, "We just want to buy a couple of 4x6s and an 8x10 or something." You've invested 4.5 hours, and the client paid less than $100 for it. This doesn't factor in the costs of gear, insurance, and other various overheads involved, let alone profit. This is unacceptable. For our engagement sessions, we run about a $1,200 average. We start at $50 for a la carte gift size prints, such as the 4x6, 5x7, and 8x10-inch prints. Now I can hear you all protesting. My clients aren't going to pay that much. That's great, because you don't want them to. We work on a package system and run a low-pressure sales cycle. We don't push our clients to have minimum orders. We let them decide what they want to spend based on what products they want and the quality of their imagery. They're free to go a la carte, but they're going to have to pay more if they do. If they go with a package instead, they'll see discounts of 20 to 40% off the a la carte prices. Starting to get the gist here? Prices drive consumer behavior. If your a la carte prices are too low, there's no incentive to go with a package. And if they don't go with the package, why would you want to reward them for buying four small prints after you've invested your time and talent for several hours? Your return on investment, or ROI, is a measure of how much you get back for every dollar you spend. I have to be able to justify the cost of items to our business. There are certain items I'd have to agree are must-have items, and other items that are nice-to-have purchases. As any successful business person will affirm, you have to continuously reinvent yourself to remain relevant in the marketplace. This sounds good, but where do you actually start? We go through a very simple exercise as a team. We call it the SWOT drill. SWOT stands for strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. In this drill, we identify and rank our influence in each of the respective categories. We do this each year. Identify your top 5 to 10 strengths. These are the things that make your business successful. Some examples might include customer service, turnaround time, competitive pricing, and so on. Identify your top 5 to 10 weaknesses. These are the things that you're doing wrong or doing poorly. Be honest with yourself, or this exercise is pointless. Use this information to transform your business. Some examples might include slow turnaround time, lackluster editing skills, outdated camera equipment, and so on. Identify 5 to 10 opportunities in your area. These are opportunities you know are out there, but which you're not currently exploring. For example, you're not going after family or children's portraiture contracts. That might be a new opportunity for your business. Identify the top 5 to 10 threats or challenges your business faces. This could be a new studio that opened its doors up the road or ever-increasing challenges we all face with new technologies. These are items that are hindering your ability to grow your business or causing erosion in your market share. Once you have your SWOT document together, you can sit with your team, even if your entire team is just you, and devise a plan of action for the next 12 months. Build on your accomplishments by revisiting your SWOT document and creating a new one for the upcoming year. Getting the most out of bridal shows. Bridal shows are the best way to get your work out in front of a lot of brides very quickly. In addition, they allow you to begin networking with your industry peers. However, like all things, you need to have a plan. For us, bridal shows are the source of about 65% of our bookings. Yes, we have referrals, but bridal shows allow us to showcase our work to a much wider audience. I love them. I love the energy they bring, and I love being able to create a fan base for our work. Finding the right show is paramount, and defining right is equally important. Once you understand your target demographic and price points, you'll have a good idea of your target bride. Is she the younger bride or the 30-something woman? Is she an elite bride spending $100,000 on her wedding? Or is she more in the mid-range? Start by doing a web search for shows in your area. Think about it this way. How are brides finding out about shows? I'd bet that the majority of them are searching online. So if you can't find the show online, how will they? Now, take that list of shows and start reviewing their websites to see if they have a section for vendors. You may find a media kit of sorts. The media kit will give you access to very valuable information, in particular, the demographics of their attendees. Ask other vendors what they think of the show. A vendor's success or failure at these events depends on many factors, including their ability to sell themselves and their product. Ask specific and objective questions about how many brides attended and what the caliber of the brides was, and so on. Remember that pesky Cohen number we spoke about in the first chapter? The more brides that attend a show, the better your odds of booking more than one bride, and the better your Cohen number will be. How are promoters advertising the show? Some of the larger shows are tied to a magazine. This is key for me. Knowing that the magazine has a certain distribution assures me that the show should have a built-in audience. This is a good sign for sure. Not all shows and budgets are created equally. Our first year, we did several of the less expensive shows. And guess what? We booked low-budget, high-maintenance brides. Today, we focus more on the middle market. The reason I like to focus on the middle market is because it gives us access to the greatest number of brides. Brides who truly appreciate what we do will be willing to spend more on a photographer. Sure, we love our high-end clientele, but there's nothing more satisfying than working with a client who had to stretch a little to work with you because they love what you do. Now that you've decided to participate in the show, the real fun begins. Preparing for a bridal show is never easy. In fact, I'll never forget my first bridal show. We booked 12 weddings from that show in the first week. It was unreal, and it opened my eyes to the impact these shows would ultimately have on our business and our future. Displays and samples. You have to understand your brides and understand what they're looking for. If they're going to shell out thousands of dollars to work with you, they want your creativity, energy, and artistic talent. We invest in having the right products to show. We want clients to lust for our brand. We accomplish this by ensuring that everything we do is of the highest quality. After all, you can't sell it if you don't show it. Don't underestimate the importance that this will have on your overall success at the shows. Don't show up at a bridal show with small prints as your sample work. My feeling is that small images are something a client thinks they can produce on their own. They regard small prints more as snapshots than professional, high-quality images. So, go big. We invest a lot of time and energy in ensuring that we have unique album styles for brides to choose from. We carefully select styles that represent our brand and the overall design we're trying to sell. If you don't have albums, go and make the investment. Almost all album manufacturers make it simple for you to get an updated sample album at a 40 to 50% discount. Your attire. You have to dress for success. Brides, at least the ones I'm going after, tend to be very fashion-oriented. If we want them to spend money and care about the way they look in pictures, we need to care how we look, too. My goal is to remove any barrier that would prevent a couple from booking us. Now that you're ready for the big show, you should have set some goals for yourself. We go into every show with reasonable expectations. At an average show, we want to book about 4 to 5 weddings to make the numbers work. Understand your objectives. We're looking for approximately 10 who get what we do, 10 couples that identify with our brand and our style. My hope is that all the work I did to prepare my booth will pay off by naturally attracting the right brides. I have no idea who those right brides are, so we treat every client who walks up like they're the only client there. Even if you don't get to speak to someone one-on-one, they're hanging around in the background listening to your sales pitch, so make sure it's solid. Sell yourself. Photographers as a whole aren't salespeople. If this is something you need to work on, be sure to do it. Practice. Talk to yourself in a mirror if you have to. Listen to yourself deliver your pitch. Does it sound natural, or does it come off as rehearsed? You have to be able to present your business to someone in about 30 seconds. You need to tell them why they should choose you and what makes you different from every other photographer in the room. Be sure your pitch clearly communicates your value proposition. Value proposition is a term used to describe the unique benefits you offer to prospective clients. Provide an incentive. At some bridal shows, we like to collect names. To entice the brides to register, we have an item we're raffling off to provide an incentive. It could be a free engagement session, a slideshow, or some other product. We have a glass bowl and a sign-up pad where people leave their information. This information is a goldmine for leads. We then use these leads to send out an email blast to everyone who stopped by our booth. This keeps generating another 4 to 6 meetings with brides. Check for bridal shows in your local area and get ready to jump in with both feet. The first show will be your toughest, but if you invest the time and money and do your homework, you'll be well on your way to finding success in the wedding industry. marketing to brides. Facebook, Twitter, MySpace, YouTube, blogging, direct mail. It's enough to make your head spin. And of course, we always have to be on the lookout for the next big social media experiment. The key with any tool is using it or them to make your job easier and to increase your productivity. The goal of this chapter is to discuss the things we do in our studio to be successful. It's not meant as an exhaustive list by any means. For us, the following tools have been integral to achieving success. In my opinion, Facebook is currently the most important social networking site and an important way for connecting with our fan base. Our brides are plugged into our profile and know that this is the place to check if they want to see what we're up to. I post lots of pictures. Clients love to tag themselves in Facebook images. Through tagging, you can get your images in front of lots of new people without having to drive them to your personal website. Once tagged, the images spread like wildfire for all their friends to see and comment on. Another great use for Facebook is to post specials that you're currently running at the studio. If you have a large enough fan base, they'll even help promote the specials for you. This is a great referral engine. Multiple clients and multiple sites. I caution about combining your personal and professional sites and contacts. Some photographers use their personal Facebook page as their business page, with disastrous results. You have to use common sense. You don't want to lose any type of client because of something they see online. I have 4 separate Facebook sites. One is a personal site where I allow my friends to connect with me and a few select clients. One is for BehindTheShutter.com, a site for professional photographers. Another for high school seniors. And the final one for the main studio. Don't rely on Facebook exclusively. Facebook is an amazing tool, but it's not a Swiss Army knife. It's just one of the important marketing tools in your arsenal. You should never, ever abandon tried and true methods of reaching your target market. Looking to the big companies for guidance, you'll see that they're using Facebook and other social media outlets to complement their core marketing and advertising efforts, not replace them. That's the approach photographers should take as well. I have to admit, with all the technology to link from Twitter to Facebook and back again, I've become a fan. Twitter is more about messaging, messages are called tweets, and less about images. I like to use it to notify my followers that we've posted new pictures. I use Twitter to hit an extended audience. There are some great tools on the market that enable you to connect this information into one place. A dashboard, really. A tool called TweetDeck gives you access to all your Facebook sites and Twitter information in one place. Genius! Another very powerful tool is your blog. You can set up your free blog in a matter of minutes at sites like WordPress.com and Blogger.com. What I particularly like about my blog is the ability to keep it branded with the rest of our sites. This is something that's lost with Facebook, Twitter, and MySpace. Lightroom has a new plugin that allows you to grab your pictures straight from and send them to your blog correctly sized and with your logo on them. Brilliant! Look for efficiency boosters wherever you can find them. They'll save you time and money. Websites are an absolute must. You need a website to showcase your work. Nothing screams unprofessional like not having a website. I'd recommend launching a custom website immediately. It's well worth your time and energy to get your business website up and running correctly. A cohesive look. As you're building your site, you should keep it in line with the overall look and feel of your brand. People who come to your site should immediately get a sense of what you're about and the quality you offer. An integrated blog. you want a blog that integrates directly with your site. And by integrate, I mean it looks like it's part of your site, not like the visitor's being redirected to a third-party site. Easy navigation. Everyone who visits your site should be able to easily find the information they need, whether they want to see wedding image samples, find your phone number, check your blog for the latest news, or read about your qualifications. Keep it relevant and current. Closely tied to helping users find the information they're looking for is ensuring that the information they do find is relevant. Keeping our website up to date is one of the biggest challenges most of us face, and most of us are guilty of failing to do so. Remember back in Chapter 1 how we talked about identifying weaknesses, part of the SWOT drill, in your business, and making a plan for improvement? One of my goals for this year is to enhance our website, making it easier to update it on a bi-monthly basis. Show lots of your best photographs. I want everyone who visits my website to see lots and lots of pictures. That's the nut we offer. Great imagery. I think it's very important to showcase our best images. I want my online portfolio to showcase that and to remain in step with the current trends and fashions. We've found that Facebook, Twitter, and blogging keep the phone ringing. You have to experiment. Find what works for you and your business. If it doesn't work, move on. If you pay attention and stay plugged into your demographic, you'll have no trouble staying relevant. We've spent a significant portion of this chapter talking about your online efforts, but there are other options you may not have thought about. These options, in my opinion, are just as powerful as, and more measurable than, your web presence. After events, I send key vendors, such as florists and caterers, images of their great products and services with my logo on them. This is a huge exposure for us. These images end up displayed in the vendor's place of business and at any bridal show they attend. This is great cost-effective publicity for the studio. I don't believe direct mail works well for wedding prospects. It's very expensive and difficult to connect with your desired demographic. However, I am a huge believer in putting something in brides' hands that they can see and touch, like our high-quality 8-page flyer. We've seen a lot of success with this strategy. We put a lot of work into ensuring that we're constantly in the hearts and minds of our couples and the vendor community that has the power of referrals. We want them to know we exist, to be fans of our work, and to make it easy for them to work with us. And there you have it. The secret to our success. So find the plan that works for you and keep refining it until it's performing like a well-oiled machine. And then, just when you figure it out, get ready for it to change. Differentiating yourself. There are multi-billion dollar corporations spending millions and millions of dollars to capture the attention of the elusive and finicky 18 to 24-year-old demographic. This demographic will soon graduate, enter the workforce, and become your brides and grooms-to-be. How do we plug into this demographic? Understand your demographic. Then it's easy to establish a brand and marketing plan targeted at their needs. This is about the bride and groom, not you or your studio. The goal of any business is to make a profit. We need to remain relevant by adapting to our market. The first thing you need to do is identify your target. This might sound easier than it is. Of course, your target is engaged couples. Ideally, we all want the trendy, fit, wealthy couples. Those are the couples with the money to spend on photography, and their portraits will make amazing images for your portfolio. The reality, however, is that this part of the market is saturated and very difficult to compete in. As a result, This is not my personal target at all. Instead, we target the first-time weddings of moderately trendy, upper-middle-class couples that place a significant amount of value and importance on imagery. That's my ideal couple. Do we always book the ideal client? No, not at all. However, 85% of the time, we do. And over the years, we've gotten better and better at sniffing out the ones who don't fall into this group. When we spot them, we politely pass on their event. There's no event we need so badly that we're willing to compromise our reputation. It's about ensuring there is a match between the client and our studio. If there's a mismatch, the client will be extremely unhappy. This will create a customer satisfaction issue that can have far-reaching negative consequences. For us, the main mismatch we see comes in the form of a client just looking to book any photographer. There needs to be some discussion before you accept the booking. I always ask certain questions, including, have you seen our website? What about our style jumps out at you? Are there certain types of images you've seen from us you like? This gives me a great indication of whether they're just looking for any photographer or our work in particular. It's the difference between being the creative director of their day or some guy with a camera. If there's a fundamental mismatch in our objectives, there's little chance that either of us will be satisfied with the outcome. The next thing we need to focus on is creating a brand that resonates with our desired clients. First, a brand is the overall identity of your business, product, or service. An effective brand is a unique, appealing, and consistent theme that runs through your name, the color combinations you use, any tagline you employ, your logo, and any other aspect of your business that clients see. As a photographer, your brand is also comprised of your personal identity and the imagery you produce. Take some time to formulate an effective brand and business identity. Who are you targeting? What's the feel you're looking for? Are you looking for more volume or a niche market? Define that niche and understand everything about it. Make your identity resonate with your target market. Creating a logo is not that expensive, and considering that it will be part of everything you do, it's well worth the investment. When working with a graphic designer, I suggest giving him a few words to work from. These are the key words that describe your business and your brand. Are you traditional, modern, or whimsical? In my opinion, your logo is a huge part of your branding effort. It should evoke a certain emotion when people see it. It should immediately communicate something important about your business, quality, creativity, or any other adjectives you have. Closely related to branding is the concept of a sub-brand. It's an important concept to understand. We offer video, wedding photography, baby photography, senior portraiture, and more. My wedding clients have significantly different needs and tastes than my high school seniors. Instead of trying to reach all of our diverse clients with one message, we've created customized sub-brands that all complement the identity of our main business. This gives us the flexibility to specifically target different clients with different marketing materials and websites. Our sub-brands offer a unique identity for our separate lines of business, but remain in harmony with our overall brand identity. All this talk about branding should naturally lead us to some basic questions about how we can better connect with our target demographic. Sure, I know who my target is in terms of numbers, their age, income, etc., but do I really understand them? Understanding your target requires you to understand how they work, live, socialize, dress, etc. I've found that if you start doing some of the things they do, relating to them becomes very easy. What to watch? Let's start by figuring out what they watch. Easy, just watch some primetime television and let the networks do all the work for you. It's an important way to plug into and understand your demographic. What to read? Spend time reading magazines. All sorts of magazines. From bridal magazines to tattoo magazines to European magazines. This keeps me tuned to what my clients are seeing and admiring, and all the amazing things our creative peers are doing. Look outside your local market, and more importantly, outside your industry, for inspiration. How to dress. You must dress for success. The old adage is true. You should think about your brand and dress yourself in a way that best represents it, as well as in a way that your clientele can relate to. No matter where we are, we try to make sure we're dressed pretty sharply. I'm a big believer that we, as the face of our company, are as integral to the brand as our photographs. This is something we're very conscious of. Here, though, are some common sense tips to consider. Avoid wearing clothing that hasn't fit in years. Avoid clothing that isn't flattering. Avoid clothing that's been washed so many times it's now a different color. Represent your brand. Yes, in the summer it's hot. However, that doesn't mean it's a good idea to show up in a t-shirt and sandals. And yeah, I've seen it. Shine your shoes. Use a lint roller. And iron your clothes so you put your best foot forward. We're not just talking about defining our own brands. We're working on defining the world of professional photography as a whole. This is something I'm very passionate about. You, as the face of your company and your artwork, are as much a part of your business's brand identity as anything you produce. The way you carry yourself, how you communicate, your style of dress, the car you drive, all these things define your brand. Our product line correlates directly with our brand. We offer very modern and high-end products because that's what our clients expect from us. Make sure you're offering a product line that connects well with your clientele and your demographic. Our brides and grooms see their imagery as artwork for their homes. It's a reflection of our brand and the tastes of our target market. We've been very conservative about choosing the products we offer. The one piece of the puzzle that there's just no way to explain is your X factor. We all take great pictures, have a snazzy website, display a cool logo, and offer access to the same products. But the one thing that separates us all from the competition are those intangible elements. We work hard at ensuring that all our clients have an amazing experience with us. We try to make the day light and fun and not seem like so much work. And our clients love us for it. This is a skill that has to be continually honed. We work hard each and every year to ensure that we're taking it to the next level and continuing to create some clear separation between us and our competitors. We want our clients to be fanatical and passionate about our studio. So take some time. Sit down and think about what makes your products and services so unique. Then start putting a plan of action into place. A workflow that works. Each time I've read about workflow, I was left thinking that running an entire technology department for a large company would be easier than operating a photography studio. But wait a second, I actually did run the technology department of a large company. The nitty-gritty reality of workflow is this. If you're doing it incorrectly, it's costing you a huge amount of money. That's the key. Every studio should follow a workflow that suits their business model and resources. Feel free to benefit from our experience and adapt these ideas to your workflow. Let's start at capture. We shoot raw. The main reason is that it gives me the most flexibility in my post-production workflow. It'll let me tweak the white balance. and also gives us some wiggle room on my exposure. JPEG technology just doesn't give you that flexibility. I definitely can't capture those moments when I'm messing around with my camera settings. I'd rather spend as much time as possible interacting with my clients on a personal level. Therefore, I practice a guerrilla style of shooting that doesn't allow for white balance cards and perfect exposure all the time. The speed at which we work is one of the things our clients love us for, especially on their wedding day, when they want to be enjoying their friends and family, not posing for endless portraits. Any time we can give them back is appreciated. Therefore, we use the available technology to our advantage. There are obviously some negatives to using RAW. The obvious one is the ridiculous file sizes. In the end, however, we are huge RAW fans and use it to our advantage. I strongly believe the pros outweigh the cons. All this talk about image size is a natural lead-in to storage technologies. There are three things to consider when adding a new hard drive: the speed of the connection to your computer, the speed of the drive itself, and the size of the drive. Drive size. The size of the drive determines how much storage space you have to work with. If you plan to add video to the mix, you'll be moving toward a world where you need a storage network in your home and studio. Drive speed. The faster the drive spins, the faster it can access your data. Most consumer-grade drives are in the 5400 RPM to 7200 RPM range. A drive you're editing pictures on, or actively working with images from, should be a minimum speed of 7200 RPM. Connection type. Choosing the right connection type can speed things up. The faster your connection speed, the faster your computer can access the images on your hard drive. So choose the fastest connection type available on your computer. We use Macs that come with FireWire 800, a very fast connection speed. The first thing I do when I get home is start downloading the images to my working hard drive. I use a device from Delkin that allows me to download 4 CF cards at a time. Best of all, these units daisy-chain together so I can download 8 cards at a time. Once the images are all downloaded to the client folder on my working hard drive, I immediately duplicate them up to a backup drive. These images are now archived in 2 spots. Making the second copy is an extremely important step. Don't take a shortcut and skip it. Today, we use dedicated hard drives that are just for backup. We back up every single image taken. We don't cull the images at all. After all, you never know when you'll want to go back to an original. It's there for one reason, and one reason only: an emergency. As you approach the editing phase, your images are all downloaded and backed up. We try to turn around images for our clients in about 2 weeks. Image selection. The process we like to follow for editing is pretty straightforward, and I think pretty efficient. Let's say we shot 4,000 images for a wedding, and this is a typical number for our events with 2 shooters. In Lightroom, we go through the images and cull them down to about 1,500. There's no magic formula here. We could end up with 1,600 or 1,200 depending on the event. I just go through and flag the ones I want. Don't obsess here or waste time toggling back and forth between multiple images. If you like it, flag it. If you don't, ignore it. Next, we delete all the unselected images. Yes, we delete them. We still have all the originals sitting on a backup drive if we ever need them. This process keeps my working drives in good order, leaving me more storage space to use for new jobs coming in. Image editing. Of the 1,500 selected files, we like to show the client 700 fully edited images that tell the complete story of their day. It's from these images that they'll be selecting a majority of their album images and ordering prints. The other 800 or so are posted online in a separate directory, clearly labeled unedited, so everyone looking at them knows these have not been touched at all. Nothing goes out of this studio that hasn't been retouched. So even if they order from the unedited section, the client is well aware that their final image will be retouched. Time is money, so I prefer to invest my time where there's a better profit to be made. We show the client the best images, and we fully process these. Fully processed doesn't just mean taking the minimal white balance and exposure corrections. We show them their images the way we believe they should look, doing black and white conversions, sepia toning, and many other editing options. I can't expect the client to have enough vision to figure out what a given image would look like in black and white or with a special editing technique applied. They hired us for our vision, so we showed them our vision of their day. Ultimately, this approach leads to higher sales for the wedding because our clients see images that they immediately want to have for their home. When viewing the final images, they can easily see our work as art, not just pictures. We use Lightroom for 90% of our image editing. Lightroom allows us to add metadata, do non-destructive editing, create slideshows, catalog files, create a web gallery, and so much more. There are some images, we call them photographer select, that need more heavy lifting. This is when you use Photoshop. We like to isolate about 25 of these images for each client. To these, we apply filters, beauty edits, textures, etc., designing a flawless piece that can truly be showcased as art. As our studio has grown, our goal of delivering client images within a 2-week window has become more and more of a challenge. We're currently shooting over 50 weddings each year, so the only way we've been able to keep pace with our busy schedule is through outsourcing. My time is better spent creating images rather than adjusting contrast and white balance settings. Our clients see the same quality of images from our studio that they did when we were editing them in-house. If you're not able to meet deadlines for your clients, outsourcing is something I would consider exploring. After editing everything in Lightroom, we export the images as full-resolution JPEG files. We then present these files to the client using a different machine in our studio. As the clients select the images for their wedding album, prints, and so on, we use Lightroom to flag the selected images. These images are exported to the print order folder. From the 700 images we showed the client, the 20 or so they selected as their favorites are sitting right there at full resolution, waiting for me to order from. This saves me so much time. Whether or not to sell your full resolution image files has been the bane of many a photographer's existence. If you're going to include them, you have to make sure you're getting enough money for them to make up for the print sales you'll be losing. For me, part of this is an education issue. Many clients know they can't get the same quality print from the corner store as they can from me. After all, our clients see our work as art, something we've strongly established through our branding. And you don't get art at the corner store. In our higher-end packages, we do give the clients their files. We do not, for obvious reasons, offer this in our lower-end packages. And we do not, under any circumstances, supply the client with our fully edited images. Ending this chapter, let's recap our workflow. Capture. Use RAW for the greatest amount of flexibility. Get the fastest CF cards possible to ensure they can keep up with the frame rate of your camera. Working Drive. Download all your images to your working drive. This should be as fast as possible. Backup. Use external hard drives to back up all the images before you cull any out. Purging. Cull your images on your working drive to your best images from an event. Delete the rest. Ensure you've backed everything up first. Processing. Edit within a tool like Lightroom and export high-resolution files for the client's presentation. for your more special edits, export to Photoshop, and work on a copy of the image. Order fulfillment. Export the images selected by the client to a special order folder where you can easily access their files for quick ordering. I hope this has encouraged you to think about your own workflow process and what you can do to streamline it. Rooting out any inefficiencies will pay huge dividends to your business in the form of time. With that time, you could shoot more or just sit back and relax. Selling, where it all comes together. We have to be able to sell the value of our products and services. If not, no one will do it for us. No matter how great of an artist you are, you have to think about your sales process. In this chapter, we're going to explore our process, how it has evolved, and examine our successes and failures. And like every other American chasing their dream, I hope to be able to retire someday. In order to accomplish a goal like that, we need to get you up to speed on some selling strategies and tactics. Selling doesn't start in the sales room. Selling starts long before that. We're big believers in the soft sell. I hate, with a passion, the use of high-pressure tactics. That doesn't free us from the need to operate with a sense of urgency and guide our clients through an actual process. The first thing you have to do to establish a sales process is commit to having a sales process. Our sales process is something we've refined over the years. And trust me, the road wasn't always a smooth one. Selling online, you lose money on each and every sale. When we first started out, we used an online sales gallery. We were spending all this time prepping for their shoot, doing the shoot itself, and finessing the post-production work. We were making less than $10 an hour. For wedding photography, the only reason you need a business space is for sales and consultations. We knew we had to find a way to bring people in, show them their images on a big screen, present the various products we offered, and demonstrate how we would display these images in their home. One day, we just decided to try it. Our very first in-studio engagement sale was $1,400. We went from our average online sale of $125 to $1,400 just by bringing the clients in and walking them through the process. There was no gimmicky sales process and no shady first 10 callers only offer. That day was a eureka moment for us. Today, we don't offer online sales. Now, we bring them into the studio, show them big, full-resolution files, and let them completely focus on one thing and one thing only, their images. We make an event out of it. We serve champagne and invite them to bring their families. The whole process takes about 2 hours as we talk about their honeymoon, enjoy the images, and show them our favorites. Almost every client who experiences this process thanks us for helping them through it. I'm a big believer in implementing a system of packages. We offer wedding contract packages, engagement packages, and post-wedding packages. By creating effective packages, we can control consumer behavior. Instead of a hard sell, we let our packages and their bundled value drive the sales process. With this system in place, we don't have to put any pressure on the client. The only limit we place on the couple is that they have to make a decision on the night of the viewing session. The pricing is sent to them a week before, so there's no surprises when they arrive at the studio. When we're showing them their images, everyone knows why they're there, to make some decisions. The pressure comes in the form of making an emotional decision about what they want and how much they're willing to spend. Packages and time-sensitive specials create a sense of urgency. Without them, There's absolutely no reason for them to decide on their purchase while they're still newly excited about the images and most willing to spend money. Without an incentive, you'll undoubtedly end up with no sale or find yourself resorting to high-pressure tactics, neither of which is an attractive alternative to me. Having them in the studio with their family ensures that all the decision makers are present and ready to listen to our guidance. We create custom post-wedding packages for each client. These packages are tied to vendor specials and have an expiration date. Why do we go through the effort of creating custom packages for each preview? Because each client is different. They have different needs and different tastes. I'm always talking to my clients about what they like and don't like. Your packages have to be compelling to the client, not to you. If you spend some time figuring out your clients, the sales will come. We usually put three packages in front of the client: a good one, a better one, and the best one. I never do more than three because it gets too confusing. Also, the packages must have very clear lines of separation, ensuring there is something for everyone. Each post-wedding package gives the client a discount over purchasing a la carte, but there is one package on the paper that gives them the best deal, usually 30 to 40% off our a la carte prices. By pricing our products correctly, I've given myself plenty of wiggle room. In essence, my packages are a way of rewarding them for spending a certain price point. Here's an example of what some packages might look like. They quickly realize that they should be purchasing a package. We've had people walk in the door and tell us they're not going with one of the packages, only to walk out having purchased our top package. And this was accomplished without us pushing them at all, which is soft selling at its best. When presenting our packages to the client, we have everything printed on very high-quality paper. We then place the paper in a nice restaurant-style leather menu holder for them to read. We present our most expensive package first. Then, we walk them through what they won't be getting in the other packages. Basically, we're pulling products out rather than adding items. It's just a psychological thing for me. Let's step back and walk you through how we're doing our sales process. The initial consultation. After the client's seen our work online, we like to set up a meeting. Most of the time we do this face-to-face. We give them several options, driven by products and services. Ensure there's a key difference between each package tier. We use albums, time, and image files as our pull-through to pricier packages. The engagement sales session. After we shoot their engagement pictures, we schedule a time for them to view and order their pictures. We send them pricing in advance, so there's no surprises. Once they're in our studio, we show them a slideshow of about 200 images, fully edited and processed. After the slideshow, we walk them through the packages we sent them and show them all our products and recommendations. Once we've done that, we ask them to tell us how they would like to proceed and what package they're looking at. That's it. The wedding sales session. About 2 weeks after shooting the wedding, depending on the length of their honeymoon and personal schedules, we conduct their preview session. This is extremely important. You have to get them in to see their pictures as soon as possible, while everyone's still excited and in wedding mode. If you wait longer, everyone will have moved on. There'll be things around their home and in their personal lives that override excitement about the wedding pictures. We start the wedding preview session evening with a champagne toast and spend about 20 minutes just talking. We really feel like we're having friends over to the house. Keep in mind, by the time this session rolls around, we've been working with some of our clients for over a year. Then we go into the presentation room and show them a slideshow of about 700 images. It's absolutely amazing to sit there and relive the day with them. We hear, Oh my God, I don't even remember that happening. I love when I hear that. It lets me know we've done a large part of our job, documenting the day for our clients. Once the slideshow is done, we walk them through the packages we sent them earlier in the week. Having purchased engagement portraits from us already, they're already familiar with the process, so there's no surprises. The packages are clearly different from the engagement session. We may have parent albums bundled in or offer larger canvases and extra pages in their album. There's always lots of different options for them and their families to choose from. We conclude the same way we did for the engagement session, by asking them what package they're looking at. I tell all my clients that my job is to create amazing images for them. Their job is to resist. There's a lot of truth in that statement, and it keeps things very light. That's our sales process in a nutshell. While relatively simple, we found that it's capable of yielding tremendous sales results. I encourage you to think about our process and try out any of the ideas that seem like they might work for you. Now, of course, I've been focusing on the positive side of all this. Like every business, we also encounter objections. It's important to acknowledge that objections will happen. And that's okay. What's important is how you handle those objections. If the client has an objection during the sales cycle and you can't adequately address it, the sale will either be lost or put on hold until their concern is resolved. Understanding a client's objections often requires reading between the lines. You have to listen to your client and really think about what they're saying to you. Once you've identified their issue, you must offer a solid response that correctly addresses their concerns. Here's just a few objections we hear from time to time. Can you post the images online before we come in? We want to wait until after the wedding to buy some engagement pictures. Our parents aren't here and they're the ones paying. My fiancé couldn't make it today, so I can't buy pictures until I talk to him. We don't want anything big. That would just be weird to see a huge picture of us on the wall. We're just looking for a few big prints for the house, like an 8x10 or something. These are nothing earth-shattering, but they can quickly derail your sales meeting if you're not prepared to respond to them. You should be able to prepare scripted answers for most objections and help the client get past their issue. Establishing relationships. This next topic is not as easily quantified, and its implementation can take years to master. Our topic is relationships. We're in a business of building relationships. It is these relationships that will pave the way to our referral future. There's a clear cycle of life in our culture. People get married and have children. Eventually, those children grow to be high school seniors. And when they get engaged a few years down the road, the cycle begins all over again. We can enter this cycle at any point in the client's life. Our studio spends a significant amount of energy ensuring that our clients are educated about all the services we offer. Our high school seniors are some of our biggest wedding fans. They love looking at the images and often talk about their own big day. This is the pre-bride approach to marketing. Even kids who haven't gone off to college yet are thinking about it. They plan to get married someday, just like they're planning for college now. It's in the back of their minds, and we can start planting seeds. And not only for them, for their parents as well. Create a lifetime program for your seniors and offer them a discount for when they start planning their wedding. If you do 100 seniors per year and 10% of them act on your offer, it means 10 of them from each year contact you when they're getting married. That becomes a huge referral engine. Every year, we book 2 to 3 weddings that were referred to us by one of our senior portrait clients. It's marketing genius. If you're not bringing the cycle of life together for all your clients, you're missing out on some low-hanging fruit. Another thing we offer all our high school seniors is a free family session. We engage all our lines of business with equal zeal because we know that referrals can come from anywhere. We want to make it as easy as possible for our clients to work with us throughout their lives. Senior portrait sessions are another opportunity to win the family unit over. Who do you think they'll call when their son or daughter gets married? This is a huge opportunity for you and your business. Yet it's one I often see ignored. Let's talk about creating a program for our brides once they've had the opportunity to work with us. This is a post-bride mentality, if you will. This is the post-bride approach to marketing. We offer a client-for-life program to our high-end wedding clients, giving them a free photo shoot once a year for life. You have clients who love you, and this makes it easy for them to continue to work with you. The real value lies in bundling it within our packages. We don't make money on our session fees. It's nice income, but we make our main revenue on the print sales. We're creating a new revenue stream for our business. Our couples know they have a photographer they love and trust for all the important moments in their lives. Tailor the program to the needs of your client base. For us, free session fees have worked. In your region, they may get excited about free prints. Ask your clients for feedback. If they're good clients who love your brand, they're usually more than willing to give you their honest opinion. If you really want to take it to the next level and get some personal satisfaction at the same time, start working with your local charities. It's a perfect opportunity for you to help out the local community and generate some new revenue at the same time. Donate something of value. Give away a free session fee. This alone carries a $200 value. We add a free 11 by 16 inch print, bringing the value of the package to $399. Either of these options can raise a nice amount of money for the group and typically bring us a very excited new client. We also inform the charity that in order for this to be redeemable, we must have the name and contact information of the winner. That way, we're driving the relationship rather than reacting to it. It also allows us to forecast better and closely monitor the value of participating in events like this. We tie an expiration date to the giveaway. Yes, we're participating in order to help the local charity, but we're still a business, and the last thing I want to do is have all these coupons sitting out there with no one cashing them in. The ultimate goal for us is to have the shoot soon and bring in additional revenue from the print sale. I'm banking on the fact that they'll love their images and spend additional money. After all, they spent their money buying the raffle item, so they're obviously excited. Finally, we give the charity a nice display to showcase our work and get people excited. We're in the image business. We frame a print and display it on an easel along with a nice coupon for the winner to take home. Try it. It'll make a huge difference. Another great way to forge relationships is by doing some pro bono work. The argument may be that if you do it for free, it's never appreciated, and it's devaluing your brand. However, we've had years of experience working with vendors and various other groups that have yielded amazing results. The key is to ensure that you're on the same page with the people you're doing this work for. Make sure you're communicating what you expect in return. Maybe it's access to their client list, display space for your prints, or access to their rooftop for some cool and unique location portraits. We run a very successful studio, so I don't need a few extra bucks from a vendor. I want access to something unique, something I would have to pay several hundred dollars for, or in some cases, something money just can't buy. That's where the real payoff comes. Make sure you're getting something in return for your time and talent. Be sure you're happy with it. If the person you're doing this work for is unwilling to give you anything in return, well, the answer should be obvious. Video, a brave new world. A blind man could see where the future of our industry lies. Depending on your perspective, you're either thrilled or scared to death. Yes, the future is video. There's no escaping it. We can be photographers, or we can be creative directors. As photographers, we use our cameras to create and craft images. As creative directors, we use all the tools at our disposal to creatively direct and document our clients' biggest days. And just like a flash or reflector, video is another tool in our arsenal. We saw this coming back in 2009 and jumped in with both feet. I'll tell you this, we had no clue what we were doing or getting ourselves into. All I knew is that this was our future, my future, and I had to be a part of it. Happily, it's resulted in a huge revenue boost for our business and created a nice competitive advantage for us. Video is yet another value-added feature for our clients. We had a bride who loved us and wanted video. She wanted something, in her words, that matched the Salvatore Cincotta style of photography. What she wanted was for us to video her wedding. When I told her I had no idea how to do this, that we had no experience with cinematography, she smiled and said, "I have complete faith in you. I know you'll figure it out." And sure enough, we did. Talk about pressure. We begged, borrowed, and practically stole to get the gear we needed to document the day. Let me tell you, it was madness. Running video and photography at the same time was no easy task. But I can't even explain to you the rush I felt working with this new tool. I was hooked, and we've never looked back. Not only is there more money in offering this, you create a level of separation between you and your competitors by offering both services in-house. Most importantly, you have creative control over the day with no compromises. Plus, it's freaking awesome. I feel like a movie producer. We offer video as an a la carte item. I don't recommend forcing it into your packages. Ultimately, not every client will want this, so you'll either lose clients or end up removing it for clients who aren't interested. We do discount video coverage for clients who book both photography and cinematography with us. If they're in our top package, we give them 50% off video. However, if they're in the lower end package, they might get a 25% discount on any video package. Pick your own discount structure. This is all about creating compelling packages. We do not allow people to book just our cinematography services. The reason should be obvious. We're still a photography studio, first and foremost. That is our primary service. Video is just a value-added type of service. You have two options to consider as you plan your jump into the video game. There are some pros and cons to each. First, you can go at it from a fusion perspective, adding snippets of video to your still photography with some audio to produce a collage of imagery. Or you can go at it from a cinematography perspective and provide a full video service offering to your clients. There are some pros and cons to these. Fusion approach. It's easy to get started, and the investment costs are low. You can use the camera, tripod, and lenses you already have. It's a great add-on service for your clients. The presentation can be produced without a lot of complex editing software. You can add this service without adding staff. Or you can go at it from a cinematography perspective and provide a full video service offering to your clients. And again, there are some pros and cons to each. Cinematography approach. It's harder to get started, and the investment costs are higher. You can use some of the tools you have, but you'll also need to add a lot of new tools and hardware. You must learn to use video editing software like Sony Vegas or Apple Final Cut Pro. You'll need additional staff to shoot video. You have to do more multitasking. You'll have to coordinate the day and allow time to shoot for stills and video, while ensuring the posing and activities you have the group participate in translate well to both mediums. Your creative process will and must change. I'm sold on video, but you'll have to decide for yourself how committed you are before you get started. We had to invest a tremendous amount of cash up front to ensure we had the right tools for the job. There's more to cinematography than putting your camera in video mode. Just as in photography, there are rules. Composition rules, timeline rules, motion rules, lighting rules, etc. This is a new discipline, and you have to invest the time to learn it. Along the way, you'll need to add a slew of tools to your arsenal. Rather than go through every tool on the market, we'll review the ones we've added to make our cinematography wing more productive. We shoot 100% Canon. In my opinion, their products are the best on the market. We currently use the 5D, 7D, and 60D. In addition, we use the Canon XH-A1s, which is a Pro Series tape-based camera. The main advantage of the 5D is that it has a full-frame sensor. Lenses. We also only use Canon lenses. Some of our favorite lenses for video are the 35mm f2, the 16-35mm f2.82 lens, and the 70-200mm f2.8 lens USM. We have lenses to cover the entire range, but these three lenses get the most use. The best part of using the Canon DSLRs for video is you get to reuse the lenses you already spent so much money on. Memory cards. We use the 32GB cards, which have enough capacity to get plenty of video, depending on the resolutions you're shooting. The key here is getting the fastest cards you can. The last thing you want to do is compromise the integrity of your video because your cards are too slow. Batteries. Make sure you have plenty of spare batteries. Video chews through batteries a lot more quickly than still photography. When we're running video, however, the batteries have to be changed several times a day. Add the battery grip to give you that extra power. Lighting. You'll need to add a continuous light source of some sort. There are many options on the market for you to consider. Cameras are getting better and better in low light, but there's still a lot of noise. This can make your video fall apart, especially if you're shooting in full HD. Adding a continuous light source will bring some nice polish to your still photography, too. We love shooting stills with our 50mm f1.2L and 85mm f1.2L when we have video lights going. It gives the images a much nicer look than flash. Stabilizers. The difference between a handheld shot and a supported stabilized shot is the difference between an amateur video and a professional film. I can't stress the importance of keeping camera shake out of your video production. We use two main devices: normal tripods for panning and tilting, and the GlideCam 4000 HD for full motion shots. The GlideCam allows you to get a full motion shot that looks like something filmed on a big-budget Hollywood film. It makes a huge difference in the final product. You're going to have to invest in pro-level editing software. You'll face some complicated editing issues when you start working on your footage, and using pro-level software will allow you to address these challenges more easily and produce a high-quality product. In most cases, you'll be producing a full HD Blu-ray disc for your clients, something that's typically supported only by professional editing software. Computer. When you're working with video files, the raw files are compressed. They typically have to be decompressed to a high-quality format before you can begin editing. All this decompressing and rendering is computer-intensive, so you'll need a fast, updated computer to work with your video clips. Hard drives. The next most important computer resource is hard drives. You'll need a lot of additional hard drive space, and you'll want fast drives. This will feed your video editing timeline. If your drives are slow or the connection speed is slow, you will fry your nerves. Television output. Video, unlike photography, can't be easily color-corrected using a computer monitor. The color space is completely different on a television, so you'll need to add a television output to your computer to correctly color-correct your video footage. Color correction is especially important if you're shooting video on multiple cameras, where the white balance is going to be a little different from camera to camera. Audio. Sound is a critical element when producing video, yet it's quite often overlooked. Any story worth telling has an audio component to it. Since cameras' onboard microphones are pretty much junk, you'll need an alternate source of audio, especially to capture key moments like the couple's vows, the toasts, and any other moments critical to the narrative. To capture audio, we use the H2 by Samson Audio, an amazing little device at an unreal price point. There are definitely more expensive and feature-rich products on the market, but this gets the job done. Trust me, if you want your video to look amateur, shaky video and bad audio are two telltale signs. Again, this isn't meant to be a full-on review of video. I just want you to be aware of where the industry is going, the opportunity in the market, and the challenges you'll face as you consider entering this exciting new world. About the author. Sal Cincotta is owner and principal photographer of Salvatore Cincotta Photography and Studio C. He attended business school, receiving his business degree from Binghamton University in New York in 1977. He's worked for Fortune Top 50 companies like Microsoft and Procter & Gamble. Salvatore Cincotta Photography was born 2006. Sal established his studio around a solid business and marketing plan. Sal and his wife, Taylor, have established themselves as a major studio covering events in New York, Chicago, St. Louis, and abroad. A second venture, Studio C, photographs seniors, families, and children. The business has also expanded into cinematography with a new company, aptly named Salvatore Cincotta Films. Sal is a contributing writer for Rangefinder magazine and has created BehindTheShutter.com as a training resource for professional photographers.